worship this morning. Glad you're here. Excited about what God's going to do in this place. And going to enjoy His presence. And you are His people, so that's completely possible. Not only does God come with you this morning, but there's also His ability to manifest Himself in a place around what His people are doing. All throughout the New Testament, He did that. And that's what we're going to do this morning, is just pray that God would show Himself strong. We're excited about Austin Coleman and his wife being here with us this morning. And I'm ready to hear the word that God's put on his heart for all of us. And just praying somebody will be saved today. A life will be changed. And but we don't want to wait to engage at the altar call. We want to start right now in this time of prayer and this time of worship. We want to completely engage the Spirit of God. That way that we're ready and our hearts are prepared for the seed. The Word of God is that seed that's going to be planted. And we want to make sure the soil is good right now. Everything's ready and we are right with the Lord. So let's worship Him in spirit and in truth, and let's hold nothing back. Father, in Jesus' name, thank You that You are good and that Your mercy endures forever. That You've given us another day to praise You as the body of Christ. And as we come together today, God, I pray that all of us, Lord, would just seek Your face and see what You want to do, God, that You have plans for us, that you knew us in our mother's womb, and You had plans to prosper us, God. You had things that You wanted us to do and places You wanted us to be. And most of all, Father, You wanted us to be Your sons and Your daughters. So, God, I pray this morning that that would happen for somebody in this service or one of the other ones, God, that even in Sunday school, wherever somebody's at this morning, that the Holy Spirit of God would work on somebody so much, God, that today they would fully turn their life over, God. They would repent of their sin, and they would turn to You as their Savior. God, bless us as we sing these songs, as we sing about the cross, and as we sing about how worthy You are and how You are alive, God. Let it be seen in this place. Let us not have dead religion this morning, God, but let us have pure relationship in this place, God. Show Yourself strong and mighty. We worship You right now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's worship together.
Love red, and There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies.
Amen. Give the Lord some praise this morning. All right, y'all gonna have to wake up just a little, all right?
Yeah.
My brother Austin here over here, he's gonna be excited and fired up. And you know, saying amen's like saying sick 'em to a bulldog when a preacher's preaching, you know? So y'all gotta get ready. Get ready for the word of God. And got some new strings on my guitar here, so making sure they're not twanging the wrong way. But I'm excited about what God's doing. I got the building almost ready to put some stuff in it, and God's just moving us in the right direction. And when I say these things, I'm saying it because I'm praising the Lord, what God's done and what God's doing. He's worthy of our praise. And when I saw this crazy picture yesterday of Chris Hudson killing a turkey, did y'all think? And you say, well, that's just the old country boy killing a turkey. That old country boy was laying almost dead in the hospital from three brain aneurysms a month ago. And yesterday, you know, God's worthy, God's blessing, God's healing, God's moving, God's touching, and he's worthy of it all. Don't let a cold winter morning this morning keep you away from just worshiping God in spirit and in truth and trusting him and saying, God, I know you're good, I know you're faithful, I know you're here, and God, I know you're always, you're never going to leave me, you're never going to forsake me, you're always going to be with me. So let's sing this song, Worthy of It All. And let's give him all of our praise.
Worthy this morning. deserve the glory.
Some praise this morning. Worthy of it all. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain before the foundations of the world. Before there was ever sin, there was a God who had a plan. And His plan was to redeem you. There was an old gospel song years ago that said, God searched through heaven trying to find someone willing to die for the sin of mankind, and it was completely untrue. God didn't look for nobody. There was only one, and He knew it before the world ever began, that Christ would be the atonement, the one who would pay for our sin. And die on that cross, and that blood that was shed would not cover the sin like it did in the Old Testament, but it would completely do away with it, forever forgiven and freed. Because of one thing, not just the cross, but also the resurrection. And that's the reason you're alive. You say, you know, you talk about a lot about abundant life. Well, that's it. I mean, if God can resurrect, if Jesus Christ, being God in the flesh, can resurrect His own body from the grave, then you tell me what you're dealing with that's worse than death that God can't take care of. Mm-hmm. Come on. Tell me the one thing that is impossible for God to do. I mean, He can't lie. Yeah, right? He can't sin, but He can help you. He can change your life. He can give you the ability to live in the midst of everything around you that looks like it's falling down. He can give you the ability to stand up and proclaim how good He is, how great He is, how merciful He is. And this song this morning, as we sing, it's a new one. It's called Because He Lives. That's the reason I live. That's the reason I have joy and peace and passion and the ability just to step out and be what He's called me to be, because He lives. Not because Matt Greer is anything special, but because the Holy Spirit of God loved me enough not to leave me to myself, but to save me. And then not only just to save me, but then give me His Spirit, the Amen. Spirit of God. The same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead is inside of me. I'm alive. Because He lives. He ain't got nothing to do with me.
That's right.
Look at my best, I'm the worst. I feel like Paul a lot of times where he said that God came to save sinners of whom I am. I'm chief. I feel like I'm the worst of the worst, but my Father is good. My Father is gracious. My Father is merciful. Amen. And He pursued me even when I ran from Him, even when I went my own direction. God Himself came to where I was at. And we're going to sing this one. It's a joyous song to think about the resurrection of Jesus Christ and how it has changed our lives. Let's sing about it this morning. Because
I believe in the Son. I believe in the risen one. I believe I overcome by the power of His blood. Amen. Amen. I'm alive, I'm alive because He lives. Amen, amen. Let my song join the one that never ends, because He lives. I was dead in the grave. I was covered in sin and shame. But I heard mercy call my name. He rolled the stone away. Amen, amen. I'm alive, I'm alive because He lives. Amen, amen. Let my song join the one that never ends, because He lives. I can face tomorrow because He lives. Every fear is gone, and I know He holds my life, my future in His hands. Amen. Amen. I'm alive, I'm alive because He lives. Amen. Amen. Let my song join the one that never song join the one that never ends, because He lives. I can face tomorrow because He lives. Every fear is gone, and I know He holds my life, my future in His hands. Amen. I'm alive, I'm alive because He lives. Amen. Amen. Let my song join the one that never ends, because He lives. Because He lives.
Father, we bless Your name. We give You shouts of praise and claps of victory that You are alive and we are alive in You. Now bless us, God, as we fellowship together, as we fellowship under Your word. May everything be orchestrated by Your Holy Spirit to make a difference in Your kingdom and the lives of the people who are here. God, we bless Your name this morning, and we thank You for life and life more abundant. Give anyone and everyone everything they need in this place today to live the life You've called them to live. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Shake hands with someone before you sit down. Glad you're at Missionary Grove this morning. All right, let's pray over our children as they go to children's church. And then let's enjoy the word of God together, all right? Father, in Jesus' name, thank you that your blessings are abundant and that you love us with an unending love, God. Unconditional, Lord. From the time we're born until the time that we die, you are in love with us, God. And I'm praying that these children would fall in love with you, Lord, that they would understand that you did everything possible in your power to bring them to yourself. And God, that you're just setting the table for them, God. You're just making a way that they can be saved and their lives can be changed. And they can change the lives of others. Bless them and their teachers. God, do a great work in their lives today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. As they're going out, I want to say what a blessing it is to have Austin and Sarah with us this morning. They are from Soul Quest Church in Jackson, Tennessee. Years ago, and I told Austin this story years ago, some of you were here when we had, most of you weren't. Most of you weren't, but some of you were when we had a revival that his father had preached, that we all got in the altar and we asked God to give us the ones nobody else wanted. Now, if that offends you this morning that you're here, well, then the altar time will be for you today. But God did that with us, all of us. We're all that. We're all the misfits and the outcasts and the ones that kind of want to just see God move and change lives and whatever it takes, you know, break our backs, break the bank, whatever, get dirty, do whatever it takes to see the gospel spread to this county and all this country and all the nations. And his dad was a big part of that. And his dad actually earlier in the year said, man, if you need someone to come speak, you need to talk to Austin. I don't know if you know that he promoted you to me, but that's a good thing, right? Yeah, so he said, you need to get Austin. Austin's great and can connect, and his message is good. And so I called Austin, and he said he was willing. They've been on vacation this week and had a good time. And so he's probably revived and ready to go, rested up. And I'm excited about him and his wife being here. So let's give God a hand clap of praise for them. And let's get ready for the word of God. Austin, you come.
Thank you. Thank you. Hey, let's hear it for the misfits. Yeah. The next thing you guys should do is when you move into the building, change your church name to Misfits Church. That would be cool. That would be really cool. Like Pastor Matt said, my name is Austin, and I'm here with my beautiful wife, Sarah. Let's give it up for Sarah. Yeah, she's awesome. She's pretty, and she's married, all right, and to me, okay? And, yeah, my dad is, he's been here before, and he's got a little less hair than me, and he sweats a little more than me, so it's going to be good. I got more hair, and I'm less sweaty, so y'all are going to enjoy that a little bit more, I hope. Before we get into the word, I just want to say thank you to Pastor Matt. You guys have an awesome, awesome pastor. Can we give it up for Pastor Matt? And that's just evident by what God's doing here at this church and how God's moving. And you don't see many churches in three services, right? You don't see many churches that are moving and growing and reaching people that nobody else is reaching, like Pastor Matt is saying. And it's just amazing seeing God use this church. So I'm just very, very glad to be here today. Now, we got here a little bit early, and my wife gave me the death stare. Married men, have you ever gotten the death stare? Like every day of your life, right? Man, let me tell you, when we got here a little bit early, I decided we were going to walk over to your new building because the church that I'm at, we have the same architect that you guys have, and we're getting ready to build as soon as we get some rich people to give us some money, and we're going to get ready to build, but we've got the same architect, so we just wanted to go check it out and see what was going on with y'all's building, see how ours might be, and we were just curious. So we start to walk through the rocks, and then I look in the red clay, right, and so I'm like, it looks dry, and we're walking into the red clay, and we're getting deeper and deeper and deeper, and my wife looks at me, guys, you know that look, and I can't even make it because I might die on the spot right now because she just looked at me and gave me the death glare, right? And it was over at that point. We turned around, and Blake was able to help us with some stuff to wipe our shoes off and everything. I'm sorry if we got it on your carpet. I'm very, very, very sorry about that. But yeah, you're moving anyway. It doesn't matter. Let's just write on the walls and stuff. Who cares? We're moving over to the next building. We actually just got back 2 days ago from Gatlinburg. Who's ever been to Gatlinburg? People like Gatlinburg, right? Yeah, we went to Gatlinburg. You know the little ski lifts they have at Gatlinburg where you can go up into the sky? You know the ones that are open air? You just pull the bar down over you? We went on one of those, and we brought our two-year-old son with us, and we set him in between us going up this little ski lift. And when I say little, I mean giant, okay? Like, we're going up this ski lift, and there's 30, 40 feet below us, and I'm usually not scared of those things at all. Like, I love going up those ski lifts. But there was something about having my two-year-old son that is squeamish as all get out, that will not sit still for anything, and my wife sitting next to me, again, giving me the death glare. Austin, how could you bring us up this ski lift and carry our two-year-old son in between us, and if he falls, I am going to kill you, okay? I will cut you. I will kill you. Like, if our son drops, it is over for you, Austin. And so I got the death glare again in Gatlinburg. I tell you that because the death glare, guys, you know this, right? The death glare will not kill you, will it? Like, if you've gotten the death glare before and you're still here, the death glare did not kill you. The death glare will not kill you, but one day there is something that will. There will be something that will take my life. There will be something that takes your life. You have friends, you have family that have lost their life to cancer. They've lost their life to accidents, car accidents. You have family members or friends that have lost their life just to old age. You know someone who has lost the battle against death. And there's something I want to tell you today that you may not know. There's something I want to remind myself of as a 27-year-old, is that every single one of us, no matter how old you are, no matter how good health you are, no matter your family history, no matter your socioeconomic status, no matter how much money you have, no matter how much education you have, you will be face to face with death. And there's an author named Stephen Covey, who wrote a book, The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People, and this is what he says. I just want to read this to you. Imagine yourself going to the funeral of a loved one. Picture yourself driving to the chapel, parking the car like you did this morning outside of the church, walking in just like you did today. You see flowers. You hear Amazing Grace softly in the background. You see the faces of friends and family members that maybe you haven't seen in a long time. You can feel the sorrow that death ushers in at a funeral. The joy of having known this person, it permeates through the entire room. Tears of sorrow, tears of joy. As you walk down to the front of the room and you look inside the casket, I want you to imagine with me a casket right here. You walk down and you look inside the casket to pay your respect. And when you look into the casket, suddenly you come face to face with yourself. And Stephen Covey says you come face to face with yourself, and this is what he says: this is your funeral 3 years from today. 3 years from today. All these people have come to honor your life, your legacy, and as you take a seat and you look at the program, you're upset with your kids for picking that picture of you, the one you look fat in, right? The only one, yeah. All the other ones, you look skinny, wearing black. There's four speakers, though. Imagine this. Imagine this. There's a casket, and this is your funeral 3 years from today. Four speakers. The first speaker, someone from your family, a son, a daughter, a loved one. The second speaker is someone that is a friend of yours that can give an aspect of your friendship as your life. The third one is a coworker to tell the kind of businessman, businesswoman you were. And the fourth is someone from your church. Now think, what is the one thing that you would want each of those people to say about you? What do you want your family to remember? What do you want your friends to tell about you? What kind of businessman do you want to be remembered as? What kind of legacy do you want to leave? What do you want the people that are surrounding you right now in this church, what do you want them to say about you? Will people that are at the funeral even know you belong to a church? What do you want your legacy to be? And Stephen Covey's experiment is one that leads us to begin with the end in mind. The end being death. See, one day when you and I are placed into a casket, when we're placed into a coffin, when we're put into the ground, we will not get back out of the casket. Once you're placed there, there's no resuscitating you. Once you're placed there, there's no reviving you. Once we're placed there, there is no getting back up again. Once we're placed into the casket, when we leave this life, what do you want to leave behind? What do you want to leave behind? And today, I want us to look at a passage of Scripture that talks about this in Philippians chapter 1. Philippians chapter 1. Death, though, there's something about death, right? Who likes to talk about death? Nobody likes to talk about death. You could be 14, you could be 94. Nobody likes to talk about death. In fact, y'all are probably upset that I'm talking about death right now, right? Death. Nobody really likes to talk about death. There's something about death that seems so far away, isn't there? It doesn't matter how old you get. The older you get, talking to elderly people, the older they get, it doesn't seem like death is really closer. It feels like, as a human, there's something in us that feels a sense of immortality, where we're not going to die. It's not going to happen to me. I'm not going to get that cancer. I'm not going to get in that car wreck. I'm not going to leave this life too soon. There's something about death that seems so far away, but there's also something about a legacy, right? What you leave behind, who you leave behind. There's something about that that also seems a little bit far away. But what I want us to see today is that our legacy, what we leave behind, but more than that, who we leave behind, it's not far away. In fact, it's as close as we could possibly get, because what you leave behind and who you leave behind is all we have. That's it. And in this passage of Scripture in Philippians chapter 1, we're looking at what the Apostle Paul is writing here. And what I want you to understand about the Apostle Paul in this passage of Scripture is that the Apostle Paul is not sitting in a Starbucks drinking a coffee and writing a book in a library thinking, man, this is going to be awesome. I'm going to write this little letter to this little church and it's going to be great. And I'm going to sip on my little coffee and sip on my little latte and it's going to be great. And they're going to love it. He wasn't doing that. In Philippians, guess where Paul was? The deepest, darkest dungeon, the deepest, darkest prison that you could ever imagine. And what scholars tell us is that Philippians, the book of Philippians, is the most joyful book in all of the Bible. And it's written from the deepest, darkest prison. It wasn't written based on his circumstance. It was written in spite of his circumstance. That Paul knew something that all of us need to know. He knew something that all of us need to know about living a life on purpose, living a life for a legacy, living a life for beyond me. Because Paul was sitting there, and I guarantee you, Paul's thought was, this is it for me. This is it for me. And so Paul was writing this book, and in Philippians chapter 1, starting in verse 21, this is what we get from Paul about a legacy. He says this in verse 21. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. To live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I am to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet, what shall I choose? I don't know. I'm torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far, but it is more necessary for you that I remain in the body. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain, and I will continue with all of you for your progress and joy in the faith, so that through my being with you again, your boasting in Christ Jesus will abound on account of me, will abound on account of me. See, Paul knew that he was leaving something more than just what was physical. See, Paul left a legacy the size of an ocean. Right? We're still talking about what Paul wrote about Jesus 2,000 years after his death. Not because Paul was concentrating on leaving something for somebody, but because Paul was concentrating on leaving someone for somebody. Paul was concentrating on leaving the one and only Jesus Christ, the only one that can change life, the only one that can give new life, the only one that can give you a fresh start. No, nothing else in this life can give you a fresh start other than Jesus. And Paul knew that his legacy was not built on what he could do, but was built on what Jesus had already done. And so Paul is leaving this, and Paul is leaving a legacy, and he's concentrating not on himself, but he's concentrating on someone else. And here's the deal. Many of us, when we think about legacy, we think about our 401k, right? Let's think about leaving our 401k instead of leaving our 401 kids. And if you have 401 kids, like, congratulations to you. Like, more power to you. You're probably bald, okay? And here's the deal. Many of us, we concentrate so much on the things we leave behind that we forget on the people and the who that we leave behind. We concentrate so much on the stuff we can accumulate, the things we can leave behind, and we miss the whole point, which is to live our life solely devoted to Jesus Christ, because only in Jesus can we leave a legacy that's worth leaving behind. Only in Him. And Paul knew this, and here's why I want us to understand today more than anything else. If you take notes, I want you to write this down. Write this down. Remember it. Tell somebody about it. Here's the deal. You cannot plan your own funeral. You can't plan your own funeral. But you can plan your own legacy. You can't plan your funeral, but you can plan your legacy. You can't plan your funeral, but you can plan your legacy. Paul's goal was never to leave stuff behind. Paul's goal was always to leave someone behind. Paul's goal was always to leave someone behind. He said, to live is Christ and to die is gain. If I'm going to die, I'm going to be with Jesus. But if I'm going to live, I'm going to live for Jesus. If I'm going to live in this life, I'm going to live for the progress of you. Paul wasn't living for himself. Paul was living for somebody else. And if your life stops with you, what a poor life to leave behind. But if you can live your life and live a legacy that leaves behind for someone else the power and the faith and the love of Jesus, what a legacy. You can't plan your funeral, but you can plan your legacy. You can plan your legacy. There's three main things I want us to see from this passage of Scripture. And from Paul. Here's how Paul planned his legacy. Number one is Paul lived for eternity. Paul lived for eternity. Paul wasn't living for what was now. He was living for eternity. And when I say he was living for eternity, here's what I mean. He built his life not on himself. He built his life not on his circumstances. He built his life not on what he could accomplish. He built his life on Jesus. To live is Christ. To live is to serve Him. To live is to give for Him. To live is to go for Him. To live is to be with Jesus. Paul built his life on eternity, and the only thing that lasts for eternity is Jesus Christ and what He can offer. Paul lived for eternity. Here's the deal. I've got a book here today. This is a journal, but it looks a little bit like a guest book that you may find at a visitation for someone that has passed away. Now, if you've ever been to visitation of someone that's passed away, you know that when you walk in, right, you walk in the doors and there's a book that's open where you go and it's a guest book and you sign the book and you tell the family that we were here, we were there to support you. We just want to know that we want you to know that we're praying for you. You're in our thoughts and our prayers. We're so sorry that this has happened to you. We don't have the words to say, but we just want to know that we were there for you. And what happens is, after the visitation, after the funeral, that book is closed. And that book is given to the family, and that book doesn't get opened back up again for someone to come and say, man, I missed the visitation, I missed the funeral, but I still want to sign my name to the book. I want to sign my book, my name to the book, so you think I was there, but I wasn't really there for you in the moment. But I want to sign the book. It's already been closed. When the funeral comes around and the person is put into the grave 6 feet under and they're buried and they're gone and the funeral is dispersed, that book is not being opened for you to come sign just so you can have your name on it. It's not happening. Here's why I tell you that. Did you know that there is a book in heaven? Did you know that there's a book in heaven where your name gets written? If you know Jesus today, there is a book in heaven where your name is written. It's called the Lamb's Book of Life. And in the Lamb's Book of Life, your name is written down when you come to know Jesus, not based on what you can do, but based on what Jesus has already done for you. When you say yes to Jesus and no to yourself, yes to Jesus and no to this world, yes to Jesus and no to your sin, when you do that, your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And here's why this is important, because when you die, 1 minute after you die, when you have left this body, when your family members have left this body, when your coworkers have left their body, this is so important, when you leave this body, there's a judgment to come. This judgment is called the Great White Throne Judgment. And at the Great White Throne Judgment, here's what happens. The Great White Throne Judgment, the Lamb's Book of Life is opened. And the Lamb's Book of Life is opened to read on whether your name is written or not. And if your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, hey, well done, good and faithful servant. Come on in. Come to heaven. Come on in. You trusted in Jesus. You gave your life to him. You said yes to what he did for you on the cross. Praise God. Come on into heaven. I've been preparing a place for you called heaven. If your name is not written in the Lamb's Book of Life, you do not go to heaven. If your name is not written in the Lamb's Book of Life, Scripture teaches that you will be turned to Satan's hell. And the reason I call it Satan's hell is because it was prepared for Satan and his angels. Hell was never prepared for you. Hell was never prepared for me. Hell was always prepared for Satan and his fallen angels. But if you do not trust in Jesus, if you do not give your life to him, your name will not be written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And this is why it's so important to understand this. That 1 minute after you die, your name will be read off of the Lamb's Book of Life, or it won't. And here's the deal, where many of us in the South, especially in Tennessee, where we have a terrible football team now, and we have a good basketball team, which is like completely opposite of what I remember growing up in the 90s, okay? Here's where we get confused. We get confused that if we come to church, if we go to Sunday school, if we read our Bible in church, if we sing a song, if we tap our foot to a song, then we are going to be okay. And the Lamb's Book of Life has nothing to do with how you live your life today. It has nothing to do with your past, has nothing to do with your sins, has nothing to do with your shame, has nothing to do with your guilt, has nothing to do with regret you've been carrying for 35 years. It has nothing to do with that. The only thing that the Lamb's Book of Life is based on is nothing you've done, nothing you could do, nothing you could prevent from doing. The only thing it's based on is the love and the grace of Jesus Christ, that one day Jesus stepped out of heaven into humanity. He lived a perfect life. He died a perfect death. He went into the tomb, and guess what? He came out 3 days later. And anybody that can resurrect out of the grave 3 days later is somebody worth following. See, Jesus came out of the grave, and it's based on him. The Lamb's Book of Life is not based on you. It's based on Jesus. And if you are living your life assuming and determined that you can be good enough to make it into heaven, I promise you one thing, you will meet face to face with God one day, and he will not let you into heaven based on what you've done. He will let you into heaven based on what Jesus did. And if you've been living your life thinking, man, if I could just become a deacon, man, if I could just be a good church member, man, if I could just be a moral person, man, if I could just do this, if I could just do that, I could just do this, I could just do that. Jesus, You don't go to heaven based on what you do. You go to heaven based on what God has done for you. That is what Paul understood, right? He was living for eternity. He knew to live was for Jesus. To die was gain, not based on what he'd done, based on what God had done for him. Second thing that Paul did to plan his legacy is that he labored. Get this, he labored for legacy. He labored for legacy because you can't plan your own funeral, but you can plan your legacy. He labored for legacy. He says in this passage, he says, I don't want to leave this life because I've got something to do and give to you for your joy, for your progress. Paul wasn't thinking, man, I don't want to die because I don't want to die. Paul wasn't thinking, man, I don't want to die because it might hurt. I don't want to die because it might be painful. I don't want to die because it's the great unknown. Paul was thinking about somebody else. Paul's legacy was about somebody else and someone else. Paul knew to live was Christ and to die was gain. Paul knew that his legacy was not supposed to be about himself. His legacy was about to be somebody else. See, like I mentioned earlier, when you die, there's a funeral that takes place. People get up and they say mostly nice things about you, right? And here's another thing. If you really want to know what people think about you, go ahead and die, okay? Because that's at your funeral, that's when they will be the most truthful about you, right? Unfortunately, we won't be there to hear it. And Paul knew that he was laboring for legacy. Laboring for legacy. See, when you die, when you leave this body, you know what people won't say at your funeral? They won't say, man, he made so much money. You know what they'll say? Man, he was so generous. That's what they'll remember. They won't remember, man, he had the biggest, baddest truck around. They'll remember, man, he made an impact in my life. And if all people remember is your truck, like, that's not a legacy. You want people to remember how generous you were. You want people to remember the impact you made. You want people to remember what you did for others. You want people to remember who you were and how you loved Jesus. How I love Jesus. That's what we want to leave behind. I like to say it this way. I want to leave my son something that he wants to tell his kids and his grandkids about. I want to be remembered for who I was and for who I loved and the legacy that I leave behind. See, Jesus sets your eternity. Jesus is the foundation that we build our life on. If you don't build your life on Jesus, Jesus himself says it's like building a house on quicksand, that it will fall away. But if you build your life on him, it's like building your life on a solid rock. See, here's what I believe about our lives is that we come to Jesus by faith and by grace alone. It's only by him that we come. It's only through his grace. It's only through his love that our lives are changed. But right after we give our life to Jesus, get this, here's what I believe metaphorically, God gives you a hammer. He gives you a hammer. He gives you some nails. All right, now get to building. Start building. Start building the legacy. Start building the life. Start investing in other people. See, God has invested and deposited in you a gift, a talent, an ability, something. And he doesn't want you just to hoard it up to yourself. He doesn't want us to hoard up our abilities. He doesn't want us to hoard up our money. He doesn't want us to hoard up our talent. He gives and deposits into us so that we can turn around and invest in other people. God has given you something. If you're not giving it back out to somebody else, you're not leaving a legacy like Paul would have talked about. See, Paul was working for the progress and joy of other people. My question to you is, are you working for the progress and joy of other people, or are you working for the progress and joy of yourself? Because you can't plan your funeral, but you can plan your legacy. You can't plan your funeral, but you can plan your legacy. See, one day when I'm lying in the casket, and my life is over, and my friends and family, they come and they speak about me, they're not going to tell the things that I accumulated. They're going to tell about the person I became. They're going to tell about the person I built my life on, Jesus Christ, the only one worthy to build your life on. It's kind of like this. A few weeks ago, my wife went to take some photos in the middle of church. In the middle of church, she had to rush out because our children's director was very, very pregnant. And she, like, was losing it, okay? And it was time for the baby to come, you know what I'm saying? And so in the middle of church, our children's director is sprinting out, and Sarah is sprinting out with her because Sarah was going to take pictures in the delivery room of all of this happening. And when she told me this, I was like, what? Like, that's going to be weird, man, but okay. And so anyway, so Sarah goes in there, and she's taking pictures and all this, and apparently they did a great job. And here's something funny about it is Sarah told me afterwards, yeah, the doctor made me hold a leg. And I was like, oh, my gosh, like, you grabbed the leg of the baby and pulled it out? And she's like, no, that's not how it works, okay? And so she meant hold Faith's leg, who's the children's director. But anyway, that's neither here nor there. So Sarah did that during church. And after church, we set up and tear down in a school gym. And so we tore down. And then I was left, while Sarah was having fun taking pictures, I was left with our two-year-old son by myself. Hello, okay? Like, if you have kids, if you've ever had a two-year-old, like, you know, that's no plan, all right? And so Sarah left me alone, and we had to go get lunch, and I had to go get lunch with my two-year-old son. And I'm telling you, listen, I am a helpful dad. Like, I'm not that guy that's just like, hey, babe, do it all and make me a sandwich, okay? Like, I'm not that guy. I'm helpful. We play and we wrestle and all that. I may sometimes, when I smell something, go see your mommy. But, you know, every dad does that, right? And so I was left with Cash, and I just realized, his name is Cash, I realized during that lunch how much Sarah does to help and to support and to really take care of our child. I realized how much she prevented him from grabbing the knife and cutting people. I realized how much she prevented him from eating entire sticks of butter without the bread, right? I realized how much she did, and she doesn't do this because she wants to say, hey, look at me. I'm amazing. I'm a great mom. What's up? What's up, everybody? I'm the best mom in the world. My wife does it because she loves Cash. My wife does it because she wants to make sure he grows into a young man that loves Jesus and that loves other people, and she doesn't want him playing with knives, right? She does it because she loves him. She labors for love. Here's the deal. 2,000 years ago, when Jesus Christ stepped out of eternity, and get this, some of us, we don't want to go into like another culture or into another area of a sphere of life that we don't like. Imagine being God, and you're in eternity, and you're perfect, and you're in heaven, and you have to step down into the mess of humanity, and you don't want to use the bathroom at a gas station. Like, that's God is stepping out of eternity into humanity, and you know how messed up you are. God stepped into that. And he did it. Guess what? He did it. He labored. He gave his life. He gave his spirit. He gave everything for you. He gave everything for me because of love. Not based on what you did, based on how good he is. And today, if you are living your life trying to live out this life that you're going to make it and you're going to do it and you're going to be good enough, you will get to the end of your life very, very disappointed. Because here's something I know about you that I don't know you well. I don't know hardly any of your names, but here's something I definitely know about you. Something I know about me is that you disappoint you more than anybody else. Can I get an amen? You disappoint you more than anybody else. You let you down more than anybody else. You are always, I am always letting me down. And if you are going to trust in yourself, who always lets you down, instead of trusting in the one that gave it all, that gave his life, that gave everything he was for you, Jesus Christ, Jesus, he gave it all for me, he gave it all for you. You can't plan your funeral, but you can plan your legacy. And the final thing that we can learn from Paul is that he died for gain. Die for gain. See, Paul wasn't afraid of death. Many of us, we're afraid of death, right? Because death is the great unknown. Death is the great unknown. We can believe in Jesus and believe in heaven and believe in hell and believe that there's eternity after death, but there's something about it that is a great unknown, right? Because death has no regard for human life. Death does not care how you were raised. Death does not care how much money you make. Death does not care what kind of clothes you wear. Death does not care what race you are. Death does not care any of those things. It doesn't care what kind of car you drive. Death does not care. Death is coming for you and death is coming for me. And death has no regard for any of the things that we care about in this life because it is coming. And Paul wasn't afraid of death. He wasn't afraid of what was to come because Paul knew to die was gain. And get this. This is why Paul didn't build his life on himself. Paul knew that he let himself down more than anybody else. Pastor Matt said it best up here. He said, I feel like I'm the worst sinner. That's what Paul said. He let himself down more than anybody else, but he did not trust in himself. That's why he was able to die as gain. He didn't trust in himself. He wasn't afraid of death. He wasn't afraid of the tomb. He wasn't afraid of the casket. He wasn't afraid of the coffin, not because of what he had done, but only because of what Jesus had done. That Jesus died, that Jesus rose again, and he walked out of the grave. And anyone that can walk out of a grave is a man worth following. And Jesus walked out of the grave, and he built his life on Jesus. See, when you build your life on Jesus, you don't have to be confident in what you can do. You just have to be confident in what he has done. To die is gain. See, many of us, we get so confused. We get so confused what life is all about. We get it flipped where we think we got to do better. We got to be better. We got to clean ourselves up. We got to start going to church before God will accept us. But Scripture, the Bible I read, says that while you were still a sinner, Christ Jesus died for you. Not when you got cleaned up, Christ died for you. Not when you came to church, Christ died for you. Not when you memorized Scripture, Christ died for you. Not when you gave to the church, Christ died for you. Where you are today, no matter where you were last night, no matter what you watched last night, no matter what kind of drugs you're hooked on, no matter what kind of alcohol you can't get rid of, no matter what kind of sexual sins you have in your life, today, God loves you right now as he finds you right now. Not who he wants you to be. He loves you as who you are today. Not who you could potentially be. He loves you who you are today. Not what you could do for him, but what he has done for you. That's the kind of God we serve, that while you were still a sinner, Christ Jesus died for you. That's what he is. That's what he does. He saves us where we are, no matter where we are, and changes us so that we can live a life worth leaving. That's the kind of God we serve. That's what Jesus did for me. That's what Jesus does for you. No matter who you are, no matter where you are, no matter what you've done, no matter how good you are, no matter how bad you are, Jesus died for you. It's the story of the prodigal son that all of us can relate to. That the son ran away from his father, that he lived it up. He came back expecting his father to be upset with him. Instead, his father opened his arms wide and welcomed him home. And that's exactly what our God does. That while you're still a sinner, Jesus died for you. With your heads bowed and your eyes closed. Every head bowed and every eye closed. You can't plan your funeral, but you can plan your legacy. Some of you in this place, you're too young to even think about a funeral. That doesn't relate to you at all. I wanna talk to you for a second that God has something bigger planned for you.
Stirring in your sons and daughters. Earth revealing heaven's wonder. Children shall behold it.
call a sinner's prayer. And the reason we call it that is because all of us are sinners. I'm a sinner. You're a sinner. We're all sinners. If you want to give your life to Jesus,
your glory fill this house. Pour it out. Let your love run over. Here and now. Let your glory fill this house.
Pray with me as Pastor Matt comes to saving people, God. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for giving us your grace. God, thank you for being with us every day to help us live a life for you. Lord, we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's give the Lord a big round of applause this morning. Praise God. Amen. You can be seated for just a minute. We want to show you a video about our Honduras worship initiative that's coming up. And then our announcements will be taking up offering during this time. And then Crispin's got something to talk to you about as we are getting ready for Easter. We're going to try to do this as quickly as possible. Got another crowd waiting to come in. But I hope you were blessed this morning. Praise God for all that he's done.
Hello, this is Miss Sheila. As many of you know, a group of us went on mission in 2018 to Honduras to help provide clean water, sanitary toilet facilities, build houses, and to share the gospel. While there, the Lord impressed upon me that the Birdsong School of Music was to help provide instruments and musical training to the underprivileged youth and help with music in the churches of Honduras. Therefore, we are partnering with Missionary Grove Baptist Church to begin to fulfill this mission in May 2019. Our goal is to take 20 ukuleles, books, and musical supplies for the youth. We will add this to the guitars and keyboards that have already been donated in Honduras. We will be teaching music and going into churches that have requested our assistance in developing music for their worship services. If you would like to help us, we would greatly appreciate it. $55 will provide one child with an instrument, book, strings, and electronic tuner with extra batteries. Any amount which you would wish to give will be very helpful. Thank you so much for considering this opportunity to make a lasting difference in the lives of the Honduran children and churches.
With us today. If you're a first-time visitor, please be sure to fill out your NGBC connection card, which is the tear-off section of your bulletin. Fill that information out and turn it in to our Welcome Center, where we have a very special gift waiting for you. Are you ready to become a member here at Missionary Grove, or are you ready to take your next step in your walk with Christ and become baptized? We have a new members class the first Sunday of each month here in the Fellowship Hall at 10 a.m. We have baptism services the second Sunday of each month at 10:45 a.m. For more information on our new members class or our baptism services, please see Mr. John Sewell. Coming up April 1st through April 5th, we will be having a week of church work days here at Missionary Grove. We have a lot that needs to be done, and we are asking for all of your help in accomplishing it. You can see Pastor Matt Greer or Brother Blake Arnold for information as to how you can help. Our Happy Heart Senior Adult Group will be pitching in and putting their hope into action that week. They will be here to serve sandwiches for lunch during those work days. If you are a senior adult and you would like to help serve, please see the sign-up sheet that we have posted on the back bulletin, or see Ms. Greta Sewell for more information. On April 6th at 10 a.m., we will be having our Easter caravan. We will meet in the fellowship hall in order to pack these goodie bags. which will consist of small gift items, food, and a personal invitation to our Wednesday night youth and their families to attend church on Easter Sunday. If you would like to help and volunteer packing these bags or riding the vans to distribute them, please be here on April 6th at 10 a.m. If you would like to give a monetary donation for the Easter caravan, please see Miss Nikki Dillahay or Mr. Corey Walker. In May, MGBC's very own Miss Sheila Hart and Miss Julie Utley will be taking a mission trip to Honduras called the Honduras Worship Initiative. They plan to teach the children of Honduras how to worship our Lord and Savior through the gift of music. The musical supplies that they plan to take will cost around $2,500. So if you would like to give a donation, you can do so by putting your donation in the offering plate and mark it the Honduras Worship Initiative, or you can see Miss Sheila Hart or Miss Julie Utley in person. Thank you all again for being here with us at Missionary Grove today. We hope that you will join us again next week. Please remember to share hope through the love of Jesus. God.
Oh, the wireless mic's working. Hey, real quick, we've had a month where we focused on evangelism, on our personal, individual calling and responsibility to share the good news of Jesus with the people in our lives. And with Easter coming up, we're going to ask that you kick that into high gear. Not only do we feel like that, you know, each of us have someone in our lives that God has called us to share Jesus with, we're going to make this real easy on you. We have these little invites made. Today's the first day you will have seen these. We're going to give them to you as you walk out the door back there. Take a few of them. Statistically, 82% of people that do not attend church say they would attend if asked. I would say on Easter Sunday, on Easter Sunday, that would have to increase exponentially. It's the number one day of church attendance throughout the year. So here's what I'm telling you. We've made this super easy for you. It's got all the details on the back, tells about our Sing for the Risen King event the night before. And we're not asking you to go into, it can be as difficult or as easy as you want to make it, and it can be as easy as just handing this to somebody and going, hey, I'd love to see you at church on Easter. Bring your family. We're going to have free family photos here that day. So, you know, that maybe that'll incentivize some people to come out, and we're going to tell them about Jesus on Easter Sunday. And we're going to be prayerfully working towards that day and the difference it's going to make in those people's lives. So you have an opportunity to impact the people in your life by inviting them to church to hear about Jesus on Sunday. Speaking of hearing about Jesus, I'm just kind of blanket comment, but if you are one of the people who made a choice to follow Jesus today, we ask that, you know, whether you stood up, whether you raised your hand, whatever you did, would you please fill that out in the little tear out in your bulletin so Pastor Matt can reach out to you. We don't believe that's something you do and you just turn around and walk away. Everybody here had somebody that walked beside them when they started taking those steps and still today. So just please make sure you do that. We love you. We thank you for being here, and we want to walk with you on this journey with Christ. So with that, let's bow our heads and dismiss in a word of prayer. Father, we just thank you. Lord, you are so worthy, and we thank you for this opportunity to come together as a family, God, and worship you. God, we thank you for bringing everybody here today. God, we thank you for the word that we received today, God, and how you just blessed us with an awesome, awesome word today, Father. And God, I pray that we leave here with just a renewed sense of hope and trust and understanding that our life is fully just in your hands, God, and that we would take that into the world we live in and share that with the people that you've given us to share it with. So thank you, Father. We love you. We praise you. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name.